It looked like somebody was bent over and had their head in the window of the deer blind. It either heard me or smelt me, and he pulled his head out of the tent and stood straight up, and that shocked me. They don't make people that big.
The way it moved, almost as if it was gliding across the beach. I've never seen anything move like that in my life. They were screaming at each other in gibberish. It sounded like a language, and they were chuntering away back and forwards, back and forwards, back and forwards. I know what a bear looks like, and there is no way on this planet that what I saw were bears.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sheriff?
Yeah.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
This is Google. And when we are not spying on you, we are listening to Sasquatch Chronicles.
Happy holidays and Happy New Year. Thanks so much for being here tonight. What a year it's been. I hope next year holds good things for all of you. And I hate to start off on kind of a negative note, but I'll go ahead and do it. Back 5 or 6 years ago, I was promoting the guys down there in East Texas and their expeditions. And I know a lot of people have been listening to old shows, or they're listening to shows on YouTube, or even going back on the archive in the app. And they're listening to me talk to Mo and his expeditions. And I've gotten a lot of emails lately about Mo not refunding people's money, or they're unhappy. And I didn't even know he was even doing expeditions anymore. But they were hearing it from my show, and now there's problems. And I don't know if the accusations are accurate or if they're not accurate. I want to go ahead and say I'm no longer promoting the East Texas expeditions or what Mo's doing. I'm not customer service. I don't know. I have nothing to do with what he's collecting or what he's returning, or even if any of that's true or not. I just don't want to deal with it. But I'm no longer promoting that expedition. And a quick update on the Sasquatch Chronicles app. It appears to be fixed. They went ahead and did an update. So if you actually click on the one on your phone, it may give you an error saying it's no longer available. Uninstall that and then go to your app store and install the new one, whether it be for the iPhone, Apple products, or for Android. And as always, if you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, go to sasquatchchronicles.com. You can become a member and get additional shows, and I hope you enjoy the app. The Best of Sasquatch Chronicles show. You know, this show is kind of cool. I have done 3 of them, and the way I generally do it is over the last year or so, I'll pull out interviews and put them in a best of format, kind of trim things down for you guys to listen to. So I really hope you guys enjoy the show tonight. It's been so nice taking time off and not being in the grind every day, taking time off for Christmas. But I started watching the show. It's called These Woods Are Haunted. And I started noticing some really strange patterns. Before we jump into the best of collection, I want to play a really quick interview for you guys. And forgive the music and the stuff in the background. I didn't add any of that. But as you listen to this, tell me what creature they're encountering.
I'm very comfortable in the woods, and that's kind of very helpful with my hobby as a cryptid investigator.
Christian and I teamed up about 3 or 4 years ago and been in the woods ever since. I'd gotten this tip from a gentleman that had odd experiences in this area that he hunted in. He described the feeling of being watched. And there's about a mile square radius in that area that they just won't go.
When we do an investigation, we research the area, we have maps.
3 miles to north.
We bring a lot of trail cams out. Just things like that, just anything to record evidence.
There's definitely a hotbed of paranormal and cryptid activity here.
That whole investigation started off real easy, but things got very strange very fast. Whew. As we were hiking in, the path, there was just tree clutter everywhere. And it looked like chunks of wood had been taken out of branches, a lot of X formations, and we just kept going on.
It's definitely this way.
One of the things that I noticed immediately is the complete lack of animal sign and sound.
Do you hear anything?
You know, you may hear some birds way off in the distance, but nowhere anywhere near.
Nothing.
It's almost like everything knows there's an apex predator in the area and just scatters.
And then I look down and there's this footprint. And it's just massive, but it was 21 and a half by 11. So we started taking pictures of that. And then about 72 inches away from that one, there's another one.
The further in the location that we went, the eerier it felt. 2 or 3 miles in, it changes and there's these trees come up and it just gets dark.
There's a pathway through it, but it's all grown over. The light was completely different. It was almost dark in there. As we're going through, we're hearing something. And it sounded like it might have been pacing us, but we couldn't really tell. And we finally came out, and the area in which we really wanted to go investigate was pretty much right there.
It's almost like a boundary point. Like you just stepped into somebody else's living room.
And I started to feel like something was watching me.
And the two guys talking right now are Christian and Daniel, and what's happening is the creature has actually put its hand around a tree and it's peeking around a tree looking at these guys. What is your guess? What do you think it is? They found tracks and now they're face to face with it. I'll give you a couple more clues. They found a deer kill with the head of the deer had been broke, and it was in the middle of all of these teepee structures. And they get paced out, and they're being paced out the whole way. Sounds very familiar, doesn't it? What do you think?
I'm convinced 100% that was definitely a dog man. I was terrified. Terrified, but I was in fear of my life, too. I see a hand, a massive hand covered in hair and claws. And it was almost like something out of a horror movie. prior to that, I had always believed Dogman was just a myth. I had never, ever in my life believed that I would ever see a walking werewolf, a real-life werewolf. I mean, there it is, right there. Daniel started moving back behind me.
Back to the tunnel.
So we very slowly went back, and then...
By that point, whatever it was gone. It had disappeared behind the tree.
We backed up into that tunnel.
As we were leaving, I believe that it followed us.
We could hear something, and it was definitely bipedal.
Go.
Now, there's always that fear that it's going to attack.
It's terrifying, because you're not sure if your next step's going to be your last. The terror builds and builds and builds. But, you know, for all you know, it could jump just right through, and then boom.
If it had decided we, you know, looked like lunch, or were easy prey, we're not going to outrun something like that, in the woods especially.
When we came out, that last footstep in the tunnel is the scariest because you don't know what's on the other side waiting for you.
At that point, we started moving a little bit more deliberately. We still have that sense of being followed.
Deer kill.
And then right across from that, there was like this pyramid structure. That hunting blind was made by the Dogman.
They were made with saplings that were bent over, and you have various types of vines and foliage weaved in.
And then I look over, and there's another one. That was a kill spot. They definitely knew this would be a place they could hunt.
Like a huff, a growl, and a bark, all put together.
All of a sudden, I hear this.
That sound will probably stay with me probably the rest of my life.
We heard another grunt.
And there was two of them.
I was terrified. We see like this black flash.
It was, I would say, at least 7 to 8 feet tall. Distinct feature I saw was like shoulder.
We need to get out of here.
All we could do is just keep going straight. We didn't want to go off trail because it would have been too easy to get lost. It would not have been a good place to be at night.
We have this large creature behind us.
Every once in a while, we just keep seeing this black flash between trees. At one point, I saw the outline of that pointed ear, and I saw that hand around a tree branch. And, you know, you start realizing how small you are. We both decided it was time to get out of there.
It paced us all the way to the car.
We just jumped in with our backpacks on, started up the cars, and just...
Go, go, go!
Got on down the road. We were incredibly relieved.
So weird, the behavior is almost identical to what's reported with Sasquatch. And, you know, I do believe the Dogman is out there. I do believe that people are running into them. I've talked to many people in law enforcement that have run into them. I've had a wildlife biologist shoot one But the idea of an upright running around a half man, half dog, or werewolf is really hard for people to get a grip on or kind of wrap their mind around it. And I get that. It's still hard for me. But you know what's weird is, In this genre, most of us believe that the Dogman is some form of demon, some form of spirit creature, even though eyewitnesses will say it wasn't a ghost what they ran into. What they ran into was very physical. Maybe it's just me. I think it's some form of spirit or demon. But then you stop and you go, why is it leaving tracks? And why is it killing deer in the same way Sasquatch is killing deer? And why are they making teepee structures? And why are they pacing them out in the same manner Sasquatch does? Just to kind of think about things. When you guys hear other genres and you hear witnesses talk about encounters, really stop and listen to what they say. You'll pick up on so much. One of the shows I did this year for the members was the Halloween show, and I went down a list of common things that people report in demonic or poltergeist encounters. And what's fascinating is you could take that list, and if I told you, you know, what is it that people are running into here, most of you would say Sasquatch, magic whispering. It's a term I'd never heard before. Magic whispering is where you hear voices out in the woods, but you can't quite make out what they're saying. It sounds like people are having a conversation in a weird language, but you can't make out anything that they're saying. And in the ghost world, they call that magic whispering. Anyway, if you get a chance, check it out. It is called These Woods Are Haunted on Discovery, I believe. I watch it through Prime. So, great show. Well, let's jump into it. You know, one of my favorite guests this year was Carla from Missouri. And about 3 years ago or so, she was out there and they had an encounter. I'm going to have her brother on the show in the future. When you listen to her encounter, you understand why he wasn't there. But, you know, Carla she didn't know what was going on. She was confused. The thing that really impressed me about her was how she held it together. There's people in this life that you'll meet and you'll think to yourself, if I was ever in that situation, that's exactly who I'd want with me. And that's what I thought when Carla told me her encounter.
It was me, my little brother, I'm 40, and at the time I was 40 and he was 38. And it was my son, who at the time was 17 or 18, his friend who was 18. They're my son's half brothers, which was 12 and 8, and we all decided to go camping. And we went to an out of the way place. Somebody had asked me on the thread, was it an established campsite? And it is, but it isn't. It's not marked. It don't have like marked off like you camp here and here's another spot. It's literally just in the woods. There's a lake that's not very large. It's got a wooden dock that goes out part of the way onto the lake. And then a mode spot, but there's no established camp spots. There's no electricity, no fire pits, nothing like that. It's just a mode piece of grass out in the middle of nowhere. We went out there because we didn't want to go to a place where we had to worry about game wardens or conservation coming up, because my brother at the time was actually on the run from the law because he had robbed a bank and he was fixing to get put in prison. So we were just trying to avoid people all together, but we wanted to go camping before he went to prison. So we go out there to go camping and fishing. We went Friday morning, I think it was, and went out there at like 6 or 7 a.m., set up, and was going to spend the whole day and stay until Sunday evening was the plan. So as soon as we got there, we set up the tent. The kids had a blow-up two-man raft to paddle around on the lake, and just all their little stuff. And we got everything set up, and my brother threw on his backpack, and he had a little 22 pistol he had with him. He took off. He was just going to go hike through the woods. And then the two older boys was out there paddling around, swimming around, or paddling on the boat, fishing and swimming on the little raft. And then it was the 8-year-old was with me. One of the things that when we had talked earlier, I had kind of forgotten about, so my son reminded me, we were, when the 8-year-old stayed with me, we was walking around through there, and I'm showing the two younger boys had never been camping. They live in the city. They've never been out like that. And so the 8-year-old, I'm showing him like what we call poke salad here that we eat here. And then things like that. There's blackberries. I was showing him stuff you could eat, stuff you can't eat, and showing him tracks, like deer tracks. I showed him the difference between a buck and a doe track, and was just kind of getting him acclimated to the woods. We spent most of the day doing that. The different ones was going off into the woods, hooting and hollering and, you know, being boys. But when we first got there, there was a bald eagle circling around on the other side of the lake, and this thing was squawking like crazy. So I got the binoculars out, and I'm looking at the bald eagle, and then I could see she's, or I say she, but this bird's flying around, and she's looking at something below her. And so I kind of panned down, and there's a large bird that I had never seen a bird that big in my life. I've seen turkey buzzards. I don't know what the closest I could find just by looking it up was a golden eagle. And I seen this bird, and I'm like telling them, I'm like, look how big this bird is. And I was telling the littler boys, I'm like, that thing could fly off with you and we never see you again. And so we were all like looking at the bird, but then we just went on about our business. The kids are playing. And my son is really good at making animal sounds, hooting and like an owl and stuff like that, and whistling. They're doing all this stuff, which now I know at the time was probably, I don't know, maybe drawing these things in. I don't really know, but probably shouldn't have been doing what we was doing. So it starts getting kind of closer to evening. Oh, and I forgot that the youngest boy, when I was showing him the footprints, he's seeing a print that looked like a human foot, but much bigger, but it wasn't like real defined. And he's like, he calls me TT, and he said, TT, because he knows I listen to Sasquatch Chronicles. He said, is that a Sasquatch track? And I was like, you know, camping stories. I was like, oh yeah. And I was like, you're going to have to watch for them. They can come up and they'll snatch you out of the tent and, you know, just telling little stories like that. And then I, you know, told him I was joking. And, but I also noticed, my son pointed it out and reminded me of this, there was also a lot of like saplings that were broke off and like twisted. And still, as much as I listened to the show, still never thought nothing about it. Just did not even think about it. We kept hearing, we'd hear whoops, whistles, knocks, but I'd only heard it a couple times and I just kind of blew it off. Didn't think much about it. Still wasn't thinking nothing about Bigfoot or Sasquatch. We're just having a good time. And then so it starts getting evening time, and my brother starts talking about this big old bird that's over there. And we knew that it must have been injured because it had already been sitting in that same spot all day. They had even took a cast net and caught some little fish for it and took it over there and was kind of throwing it at it, hoping it would eat because we thought it was injured or maybe hung up in some fishing line. Well, my brother's like, it's getting close to dark. And he's like, I think I can make it over there to that side, hike over that side and check on that bird and make it back before it gets dark. He said, I want to see if it's got fishing line or something around its foot. And he said, I'm going to cut it so it can fly off. He said, because I feel bad it's just sitting over there and it's going to end up dying. So he takes off, throws his backpack on, takes off back off to the woods. I'm cooking dinner for everybody, not thinking too much about it. Well, then I think, well, he's probably getting back close to the bird. So I walk back out to the lake, take the binoculars. I look across the lake at him. I can see him walking, and he hollers across the lake and said, am I getting close to it? Because he wasn't sure exactly how far down the bird was, and he couldn't see it, couldn't see very well. And I told him, I said, I don't see it. And I was trying to kind of scan around, look for this bird. Something splashes the water pretty hard right next to where he's standing. And when that happened, I kind of chuckled because I seen him like through the binoculars. I could see him kind of jump, and I could tell it startled him. And I'm thinking a beaver has slapped at him, and I thought it was funny that it scared him. By this time, all the boys are all standing next to me because they're also trying to, without binoculars, look for this bird. We're standing there, and all of a sudden you see, at first didn't know what it was. You just see something come up in the air out of the woods. And then you seen a, heard a ka-thunk, and this was big enough that like it was like the rock hits the water, and then it's like, you know, like a second or whatever, maybe a split second, and then you hear the waters, you know, splash down. It was just something really heavy. I'm trying to wrap my mind about like what that was, because obviously it wasn't a beaver. I seen something get thrown in the air and fly into the water like at an arched angle. And I kind of I'm looking and my brother's, I could see him, you know, his eyes are darting around and he's trying to figure out what's going on. And about that time, another, and the last rock that got thrown, I don't even know if you would call it a rock because it was huge. And I see it go up in the air and you could actually hear it through the wind coming. And we're like kind of all watching it at the, our eyes are going up watching the arch of this thing, and it hits the water, kaboom, and it makes a huge splash. And he said, my brother screams, he's like, what was that? And I didn't know what to say, and I just screamed, run, something's throwing rocks, because I had no idea what was going on. I mean, I guess in the back of my mind, I was might have been at that time thinking Sasquatch or something, but I was just like, get the hell out of there, something's throwing rocks at you. And about that time, I seen him throw his hands up, almost like if somebody had a gun on him, he put both hands up in there. And he said, whoa, whoa, whoa. He's like, I'm leaving. He's like, I'm not trying to. He said I'm backing out of here or something. And maybe I'm not trying to get in your way or something like that. And he starts walking backwards and I'm watching him. And I tell my son, we had a .22 rifle with us for case snakes or something. And I told him, I'm like, go get the rifle, because as all this is happening, I swear every Sasquatch Chronicle episode is going through my head. And all I could think was, I've heard people on your show say they seem to know what a rifle is. And even though it's a .22, I'm like, they're not going to know it's a .22. So I tell him to go get the gun, and he runs up with the gun, and I point it towards where my brother is at across the lake. I'm just kind of watching through the scope, looking to see if I can see anything. And I see, I'm still seeing him. He's walking backwards and he's steadily talking, like he's talking to somebody, saying, I'm leaving. And he's walking backwards pretty slow because it's really thick. It's not a maintained spot. It's blackberry bushes and briars and everything else over there. And he's slowly walking backwards. And I couldn't see anything other than him, which I was mostly focused on him. But I'm looking with that scope because I'm like, if something comes up on him, I can at least try to scare it off, or if I have to shoot something or whatever, so he can maybe have a chance to get away. And then finally he makes it to a point where he's in thick enough woods that I can no longer see him, but I'm still kind of sitting over there, and I know like he'll have to walk a pretty good distance and then he's going to hit the dam, and that's all clear, so I could see him again on that dam. And he had a little headlamp on too. And so the boy, you know, the kids are like, you know, what do you think did that and all this stuff? And I'm like, I don't know. And I was like, I don't know if somebody's over there. I don't know what's going on. But I'm still, even though this lake, I say a lake, but this is not a very big lake, I don't know why it never crossed my, I still felt safe because I'm like, that's happening over there. We're okay because we're over here. But I mean, it just is all connected. It walks in a circle. So, but I was just like, we're good. We're over here in this mowed grass part. So I guess I felt safer over there for some reason. So we go to sit by the tents. And I was like, so then I walk back up and I see my brother is on the dam. So I'm like, okay, so he's made it to the dam. He only has to come down on the other side of the lake. So he don't have very much further. He's over halfway here. Nothing's following him on the dam. I can't see anything. I just see him walking. He's not running. He seems calm. He's just walking across the dam. So I feel comfortable then. So by that time, I'm like, he's okay. He's made it to the dam. He'll be coming down this way soon. At that point, me and the boys just start talking about the rocks getting thrown. And I was like, well, that's kind of a cool experience. Like, you know, kind of scared the younger ones. But I'm like, we're okay. I said, it's just something throwing rocks. And we're talking about, you know, is it Bigfoot and this kind of thing? And I'm like, probably not. And I was like, maybe. I was like, I don't know. But we're okay because that was over there. We're over here. And I said, so we're fine. We're safe. We'd all kind of calmed down from the rock throwing, waiting on my brother to get there. And then, so we go over by the tents. And by this time, it's dusk just before dark. I mean, it's starting to get dark. And I'm just kind of thinking, I'm like, well, I hope he gets out of there before dark because it's going to be hard for him to see. But I still don't worry about him getting lost, because as long as he follows the bank line, it's going to lead right to us. I mean, as long as you're following the water, you're fine. So we start walking over by the tents, and we stop because we hear, hey, it sounded like, hey, I'm over here. And of course thought it was my brother coming, because that's where he would have been walking out of the woods at. And my son, all the kids start walking away. My son was kind of leading the pack, and he starts to go off into the woods, and I tell him, stop. I said, do not take another step into those woods. And he's like, what? And I was like, come back, and he comes, they all come back towards me, and they're like, what? And I was like, they're like, it's Leon. And I was like, no, it's, I was like, something's not right. Because when I say it says, hey, I'm over here, when I think back, it wasn't as clear as me saying it. It was almost like just that, like something mimicking that sound. And it wasn't, I don't know, it's really hard to explain, but it just didn't sound right. And immediately I was creeped out, like I just, like all my hair standing up. And my dog, I had a chocolate lab with us. He immediately like hunkered, like he kind of bows down and he's like, look, got his head bowed down and he's like growling towards the woods. And I hurry up and hook his leash on him because I don't want him to run off into the woods, and tell the boys, I'm like, everybody get back up here. And then now I'm kind of getting scared again because I'm like, I don't know what's going on. But I'm still not panicked because I'm thinking, okay, if he's close enough, we heard that, because it wasn't hollering. It was just, hey, I'm over here. I'm like, he's going to walk out any second. And then we start hearing weird growling noises and just whistling and just all these different noises. And but at that time, only sounded like one thing doing it. And so my first thought is my little brother's messing with me. And so I say, I've obviously got the rifle. And I said, if you're trying to play a trick on the boys and scare them, stop, because you're scaring me. And I'm like, I've got the gun loaded. And I'm like, you're going to get shot. And he knows, like, he wouldn't just keep on if I say that. Like, he would be scared I would shoot him. So I tell him, like, don't be messing around. And he never walks out. And I'm like, I don't know what's going on. So I tell everybody, I'm like, nobody stray off. If you got to go bathroom, go pee on a tree close, but go with somebody else. Nobody separates from each other. And I'm trying to keep everybody kind of together. It's steadily getting darker at this point. And then we start hearing what sounds like, we hear, it's further into the woods, but we hear what sounds like possibly my little brother screaming, help me. But it goes, help me. And then it immediately goes into like a really long, just scream. And so then now I'm really panicked because I'm thinking something, like, I don't know if that's him. Is something like hurt, something attacking him? I don't know what's going on. Now the kids are scared. And I'm like, we may be in real trouble here. Well, by this time, something has come on the other side of the lake. So it's just a dirt lane. You got the lake, and then all around that is woods other than the dirt lane. But the part that is mowed is it's not a real big spot. So you feel very like you're in a really tight spot, and you don't have a lot of leeway to move around or do anything with, really. So I'm like, so we know something's coming up from now behind us, and it's over there making noise, and we hear whistling, and then like a clacking sound, and like growls and stuff come from over there, and limbs breaking. And then something at the direction, which I'm saying in front of us, because that's the way we're facing, is where I'm thinking my brother should be walking out, and he's not walking out. And then the screams of screaming, like, help me, and all this come from that direction. And my son was like, we need to go in there. And I'm like, no, we don't. I'm like, because I was like, that's just going to make things worse. We're not going into the woods. And I tell the two younger ones, I'm like, you guys get in the car and don't get out. So they get in the car, and then I'm like, tell the two older ones, I'm like, let's just break down camp because we're not staying here. I'm like, this is crazy. I said, when he gets back out of the woods, we're leaving. So as we're breaking down camp, still, okay, the whole time we're doing this, all these different noises are in a circle. The only place we are not hearing noises, we're on the water. All the woods around us, there's just constant stuff breaking, whoops, whistles, growls. I told the boys, I'm like, I know it's scary, but I think they're just trying to get us to leave. They're just trying to push us out of here. And I'm like, and we're going to leave when my brother gets out of the woods. So we're trying to break down camp. And then all of a sudden this tree shakes, and it's like, I think it was a pine. It's a tall pine tree. I guess they're called pine trees, but this is a live, a massive tree, a live tree. And this thing just, you start hearing like extremely loud pops, and this tree comes flying down and slams into the ground. It hit the ground so hard you could feel it in your feet. And then I'm getting really scared because this is a small dirt lane that leads out of this place. And I'm like, if this thing pushes a tree over, this road, well, that's it. We're stuck. We're not coming out of here. And I'm also steadily concerned about my brother, who I know at this point, I'm like, he should have already walked out. It's not that far. He shouldn't have got turned around. He should have been able to walk right out. He had done it multiple times that day. He'd walked around the whole lake pretty much. And so had the boys. So I'm like, I know he should be out. So now I'm scared because he's not out. And I'm telling my son, I'm like, I don't know what to do. I'm like, because I'm like, I don't know if I should go try to get signal and call for help. I'm like, but if I call for help and he's okay and he's just whatever, taking his time or got a sprained ankle, or with him, sometimes like he might, if it gets dark, he'll just camp right where he's at. He'll just stay right there till daylight. And I'm like, I don't know if I should go try to call for help. I said, but if he's fine, then everybody's gonna be mad because they're obviously going to arrest him right then and there. And I'm like, and if I don't call for help and he's getting killed, everybody's going to blame me for saying, well, I'd rather him be in jail than dead. And then plus I've got to worry about the kids that I have with me who are scared to death. And I've also got to worry about their safety. So we start breaking down camp. The tree gets knocked down. So I'm like, forget it. Don't break, like, just leave it all. I said, get up here by the car. So we're all going to stand by the car. All we have is our 22 rifle. The two boys and the dog are in the car. Well, my son and his friend, because I made sure everybody stayed at least two people, walk around the other side of my car to the passenger side. And the stuff we already had on the luggage rack of the vehicle, they was going to tie that rope down, basically. Well, they get over there to tie it down, and my son and his friend are like, they come back around, and my son's friend said, there's something. He said, it's so close to the car, it felt like you could feel it breathing down your neck. It's so close. So I tell him, okay, don't tie it down. So basically what we did was just take the rope, throw it through the window, and was like, when we get ready to leave, we'll just hold that rope. And then if everything flies off, I don't care. Like at this, I don't care about any of the stuff we have with us. We had just bought new camping equipment. I'm like, I don't care about any of that stuff anymore. So you can tell everything around us is surrounding us is getting more and more aggressive. And then we hear this, well, I don't know. I say here, you didn't really hear it, I guess. You felt like this, I don't know. It's like, I guess like a vibration. I don't know what that was, but my dog started acting very bizarre after that. He was acting very strange. The two younger kids in the vehicle instantly said, I don't feel good. And everybody had a headache. So I'm at this point, I say, okay, I get in the car. I turn all the lights on and I'm like, we'll just sit in the car. But then I'm also worried about my brother, and I'm taking a flashlight, getting out. We're looking, kind of checking the woods and kind of shining the light, hoping he'll see our flashlights to come in. I'm hoping he'll see. I turn the flashers on in my car, hoping that'll help him come in. But meantime, the whole time we're seeing, you can see, like, not detail, like I can see its face and eyes and all that stuff, but you would see these silhouettes running from tree to tree, just out of the line of any kind of light. You can hear them, like you can feel you can hear them running, and you can feel them running by the vibration. And then of course they're hitting trees and snapping trees, and we're seeing them, the whole outline of these things running, but it was just far enough. It almost confused your brain. It was so fast, like going from one tree to the next. By the time you kind of look the direction that it's running, you can't see it. And it's literally close enough. You could toss it. Like, I know I could toss a rock and hit one easily. They're just out of our range. And you could definitely tell they were communicating with each other. That I will say, it was just hard to explain, but I knew that they were everything they were doing was, everybody knew what everybody was doing as far as these things are concerned. So I tell my kids, I'm like, okay, I don't know what else to do. Get in the car. And I'm like, we're just going to drive the dirt lane out towards the highway. And I was like, and turn around and come back. I said, and I'll just make that loop so that these things think we're leaving. And then hopefully I'll see my brother, or he'll hear or see the vehicle or whatever, and or give him time to get back to us. And so that's what I do. So I go out, I make it almost to the highway, I hit a little turnaround, I come back, We come back and I kind of roll down the windows. I'm sitting there listening. We don't hear anything. So I'm thinking, okay, they think we left, so we're good to go. So then I was like, okay, I think we can get this camping stuff. We get out, and as soon as we started messing with that camping stuff again, all hell breaks loose. So I'm like, just forget the camping stuff. Like, okay, once again, we're done with the camping stuff. So I'm honking the horn, hollering for my brother, you know, and my son was like, Mom, we just need to leave. He's like, otherwise we're all going to be dead. And he's like, so we need to leave. And I said, I'm not leaving my brother here. And he's like, he would want you to leave. And we're kind of arguing back and forth about this. And he said, he told you if anything happened, just leave and then come back for him in the morning and he'll make his way out or whatever. But I just kept thinking about the screams I was hearing. I can't explain the panic. I had no doubt the more this stuff was ramping up, I'm like, if it was coming to a point, I was either going to have to leave my brother there, or if we stayed, these things were, it was not going to be good. Of that, I had no doubt whatsoever. I had no doubt of that because they were just getting more and more aggressive coming up. At this point, we're all in the vehicle, so they're coming up closer to the vehicle, but they never come up in the headlight side. They always stayed at coming to the sides of the vehicle every time. It was to the sides, throwing, I don't know if it was pebbles or acorns or something. They were throwing something small and hitting the vehicle. And so one more time, I'm going to make this loop and come back onto the gravel. And as I'm circled to come back towards the camp again, my brother pops out of the woods at a totally different spot of where he should have come out and runs and jumps in the car. He's covered in sweat and he's like, and it's going to sound disgusting, but he's like, I'm sorry if it smells in here. He's like, I shit my pants. And I was like, where have you been? Like, what took you so long? And he said, I came off the dam. He said, and started walking down towards the camp. He said, and I knew it wasn't. He said, it's just a straight shot. He said, I knew it wasn't very far. He said, but I got where I couldn't see. He said, then I kind of thought I was maybe getting turned around. But he said it sounded like something on his left and something on his right, like something just walking beside him. He said, I couldn't see it, but I could hear it. And he said, so something's walking. He said, but it's not, you know, at this time being aggressive. It's just pacing him, basically. He said, I should have come out of the woods by now, and I'm probably going to get turned around, so it's better. I need to just stop where I'm at. So he's like, I'm going to build a little fire and just sit here till morning. He said, as soon as I sat down and started trying to build a fire, he said, it started breaking limbs, pushing trees over, growling, clacking. I think he said whooped and whistled. He said, so I was like, okay, you know, I'm out. And he said, I got up, started walking again. He said, I'm thinking this is taking way too long. Like he is worried about how turned around he is and where he's heading. He said, then he starts thinking, are these things like ushering me towards something? And he's like, because I cannot tell where I'm at and where I'm going. He said, so I was like, I don't care what happens. I'm just going to stop right here and, you know, hopefully they won't mess with me. He tries to stop again. Same thing. All hell breaks loose. He said, when he sat down the second time, he said, I was not that far from the road. He said, I probably could throw a rock and hit the road the second time. He said, but I couldn't see the road. He said, I couldn't tell I was that close to the road. He said, till I seen your headlights come by. He said, when I seen your headlights come by and you passed me, because I couldn't see him in the woods, he said, I thought you were leaving. He said, and then I seen him coming back, seen headlights coming back, and was like, you know, whoever it is, I'm going to flag him down. But it was me, obviously. And that's when he jumped in the vehicle. He said, every time I would try to stop, he said, and the last time he tried to stop, he said, I thought this thing was going to kill me. He said, I know it was right next to me. He said, I couldn't see because I couldn't see anything. He said, you can't see your hand in front of your face. He said, but I could tell it was right there by me. And now I know that they were probably trying to push him towards the road because that's where they kind of guided him to. And they were way less aggressive than, I mean, I know the snapping trees and making noise, but that's all they did with him was they never like pushed trees towards him. He was scared, but not, he said he didn't feel like necessarily that, he said he felt like if he stayed, it was going to get bad, but it wasn't going to be bad if he just kept going. But they definitely, he said, he don't know that he would have found his way out had they not pushed him towards that road. Now, us, on the other hand, was much more aggressive, and it was almost like they were playing with us. Like, first it seemed like, okay, we want you guys to go, trying to push us out. But the longer we were there, the more aggressive they were getting, making more noises, more bizarre noises. And then it was just it was like the tone, you could just tell it was just amping up. And it was getting to the point that I'm thinking, like, I'm going to have to make a choice here. My brother or the kids. Obviously I would have 100% chose the kids, but I also felt like if I left my brother, that's it. Like, if I drive off and just leave him there to camp for the night to deal with this on his own, if I come back tomorrow, he is definitely not going to be alive. Of that, I just almost had no doubt because of these things, how much they were ramping up. Maybe not the two that was pacing him out, but all the ones that was by us were definitely more ballsy. It seemed like they knew the limit of your vision of what you could see. And they were so fast. I mean, you would just see like a black flash go, and it would just your eyes could not fixate on it quick enough. And your mind couldn't wrap around what you were seeing quick enough. I know it kind of sounds weird, but it's the only way I know how to explain it. It just is like my brain didn't have time to process what I was seeing. I had a million things going through my head on what's the right decision. What, you know, am I doing the right thing? Am I not doing the right thing? Should I go to the highway and try to get signal and call for help? Should I not call for help? Like, what am I going to say if I do call for help? It was just absolutely insane. I didn't care. I never once thought about whether or not I was leaving the stuff. That stuff was getting left there. We never did go back for it. And just the way my dog was acting, at first he went from protective to scared to almost like, he just had this weird look in his eyes. Like, he got very confused and almost, my dog almost seemed disoriented, if that makes sense. He seemed like he was very confused about what was happening and seemed very disoriented, like he couldn't get his senses about him. This big old bird that had been there for, at that point, by 8 hours, it sat in the same spot, it was gone. So I kind of wonder, I don't think anybody ever goes on the side where the bird was at. Normally people don't go there because when I say it's not maintained, I mean, you're walking through briars. It's just not a normal place to walk. There's snakes. It's just not a good place to walk. I don't think anybody goes on that side of the lake. I think maybe if they were over in that area, maybe they knew that bird was there and had maybe was going to use it for a meal. The kids are peeing on everything. They're breaking limbs. They're snapping. They're hooping, hollering, whistling, making animal noises. I think we did everything wrong. But when we were doing it, even though I believe in Bigfoot and all that, I didn't think they were there. And I didn't, looking back, hindsight's 2020, we shouldn't have been doing the things we were doing because it was almost like we were just begging them to come at us.
It's a scary account, and Carla did a great job coming on the show. Thank you again, Carla, for coming on, and I can't wait to interview your brother when he gets out of the clank. You know, one of the other encounters that really sticks with me this year was John from Oregon, and John is a 20-year military vet. He suffered from PTSD pretty bad. He would stay out in the woods and just away from people. And this moment in time changed his life forever.
I grew up in Portland, Oregon, and I had been in the military for 20 years. And whenever I got out, I had had some bad experiences with deployments and things. I am a combat veteran, and my PTSD was off the chart, and I was looking to just get away from people. I really didn't identify with people. I was pretty antisocial at the time. And I had, through the VA and disability, I had come into a sizable sum of money, back pay that I should have got. And I used that to purchase some acreage about 45, 50 miles west, southwest of the Dalles, Oregon, near the east side of Mount Hood. And the idea was that my wife was going to continue to work during the week and then come out there on the weekends. And my father took his fifth wheel out there for me to live in. And I just stayed out there, and I was going to build a cabin that we could vacation to and go to on the weekends, and then eventually, whenever my wife was old enough to retire to. So I'm out there, and I have a lot of relatives in the Portland area who had made their living in the construction industry, and I had an uncle who had a business where he rented heavy equipment to people. So he had brought a big backhoe out there, and my cousin, who was a heavy equipment operator, had been coming out on the weekends to help me dig what was going to be the basement, but it was a big hole, and we were going to put the foundation all through it. And the hole that we had ended up digging was about 30 feet by 40 feet, and it was about 12 and a half feet deep. When we had got the hole finished, my cousin loaded the backhoe up onto the trailer that they hauled it out there, and my uncle was going to come get it the following weekend. So I'm basically living out there in a fifth wheel, camping, and doing a lot of work around the property during the week, you know, clearing out underbrush and pulling it in and burning it. And so one night, after about a month and a half of me living out there, I was asleep. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning or so, and I heard a big bang against, you know, something very heavy hitting against metal. So I got up and I didn't have any night vision and, you know, no electricity, but I had lanterns, and I grabbed my Surefire flashlight, and I stood in the doorway of this fifth wheel, and I shined it around the only metal thing out there, which was the trailer containing this big backhoe that was right next to this giant pit in the ground. And I didn't see anything. So I went back to bed, and I laid there, and I listened, and I didn't hear anything. So when the sun came up, I went around there, and I'm looking. Near there, there's a big giant pile of dirt and rocks that had been dug up from the hole. The backhoe is dirty. We hadn't even cleaned it yet. I didn't see anything on there where any of the dirt or anything had been disrupted. I didn't see any tire tracks. I thought maybe something had flown into it, or, you know, an animal had run into it or something. So I just carried on with my day of doing the chores that I had been working on out there. The next night, right in the middle of the night again, I heard it again. It was something heavy hitting metal, a big bang sound. So I laid there to see if I heard it again. And after a few minutes, I heard it again. So I jumped up and I had all my guns out there with me. And one of the guns that I had happened to take out there with me was an M4 with an aim point sight on it, because that's what I was used to carrying in the military. So I grabbed my M4 and my Surefire and opened up the door, and I looked around and did not see anything. And at this point, I'm thinking that some people from town, some kids or something, were out there messing with me. So I yelled out, "You better get out of here." And I didn't hear anything. So I closed the door and went back toward the bunk where I was sleeping, and I heard the bam again. So now I'm angry. So I flipped the door open again, and I said, "I'm armed and I will shoot you. Don't try me." And I looked around, and I'm shining the flashlight around, looking for any movement, listening. I don't see or hear anything. And I no sooner than closed the door to the fifth wheel again, I mean, the door clicked and I heard bam again. So I threw it back open, and I'm looking around, and I don't hear anything. And basically, I just propped my butt down on the floor of the camper with the door open, shining my flashlight around until the sun came up. So that was that night. And the following night, I'm laying in bed, and I'm listening. I had stayed up. One of the things that I didn't tell you when you and I had talked before, I had built a big bonfire, and I was going to just stay out there all night. And I made a show of, because at this point I'm still thinking that it's kids out there messing with somebody, that, you know, maybe this, I'm in their old drinking area or something. I don't know. Kids from the Dalles or Hood River had come in there, and they're just messing with me. So I built a big bonfire. I made a big show of bringing all my guns out and sitting on a lawn chair out there and really slowly cleaning my guns and looking around, you know, show anybody that's watching me that I'm armed. Eventually it got quite late, The fire had burnt down, so I hadn't seen anything, hadn't heard anything, so I went back into the trailer. I get into bed, and I'm laying there for a while and not hearing anything, listening for everything. I can hear crickets outside, so I'm thinking, okay, there's nothing out there. And I fell asleep, and about 4:30, I heard the bang, something heavy on metal again. And I jumped up, threw my pistol in my holster, grabbed my M4, and I ran to the door, and I waited. And when I heard the bang again, I was ready to jump out, and then I heard what I thought was a woman screaming, only it was really, really loud. It sounded like it was coming from right outside the door of the trailer. In my head, it sounded like a woman who was in severe pain or being brutally attacked or something. It was just a desperate scream over and over and over again. So I took a deep breath and I prepared myself. And whenever I threw open the door of the fifth wheel, I was at a run. And the door to the fifth wheel is about 30 to 40 feet from where this big hole is in the ground. I've got a combat sling on my M4. I've got the Surefire up on the handguards of the M4, and I'm aiming in the direction of the pit as I'm running up there. As I'm running up there, I can identify there's two shapes that I can see on the far side of the pit, which would have been, it was about 30 feet from one side to the other. One of them is quite large. All I'm seeing is dark shapes. This is about 4:30 in the morning. The sun is just starting to lighten again with the coming of the sun. One large shape, very tall, very big, massive, and then another shorter shape, but it was really long. And I'm not identifying what it is that I'm seeing. I run up to the edge of the pit. Before my brain tells me to hit the brakes, I hit the brakes, and I'm seeing this before I actually arrive and stop, and my brain is having trouble processing what it is that I'm seeing. The only word that comes to mind were beasts. I've heard the term monsters used, great apes. These were just giant, massive beasts. The one that was shorter appeared shorter because it was laying on the ground. But the way it was laying, wasn't laying the way a person would lay on the ground, where your whole body is laying on the ground. It had one hand beneath it, and it was on its toes, and it was looking like it was reaching down into the hole. In the time it took me to run from the camper to the hole was only a few seconds, and it had sprung back up onto its feet. Now, my M4 and my flashlight are pointing right at these two things, and they both let out this noise. It almost looked cartoonish. They slightly bent at the waist like they're throwing their voices at me. And it was somewhere between a scream and a roar. But when it hit me, I felt this sense of fear. And I had felt fear before. I had been in combat situations plenty of times. And I had felt fear before. The feeling that came over me that you and I had talked about was my body wanted to void itself of everything. I felt instantly nauseated, like I wanted to throw up, I wanted to urinate, and I wanted to defecate. And I think had I eaten anything right before I had gone to bed, I probably would have. While all that is going on, I'm also feeling extremely fatigued, almost like percussion fatigue, like if you're shooting your gun a lot, the percussion of a high caliber gun can sometimes, just beat on you. Or if you've been to like a lot of concerts and stood too close to the bass or the amplifiers or things, it just kind of beats on you. So I felt this feeling of fatigue, like all I want to do is lay down right here, regardless of what's going on, and just go to sleep. I don't care what happens. I just want to go to sleep. Their roar scream lasted 3 or 4 seconds, and my weapon was still pointing at them. And the creature I don't want to make it sound like they were on my left, right side or my right side. They were ahead of me, but there was one on the right and one on the left. And the one on the left went into this stance like it was getting ready to take 3 or 4 steps and then jump across the hole. and attack me. And in my brain, I'm thinking it could probably make it. And if it gets on this side of this hole, I'm going to be toast. In my peripheral, with the light of the Surefire flashlight I was using, in my peripheral, I can see movement down inside the hole. So I took a quick glance down, and there was another creature down in the hole that was a lot smaller. It was maybe 4 feet tall. While all this is going on, I have another sense that to my left on the far side, I have the trailer with the backhoe on it on my left-hand side. And I can sense movement and hear movement on the far side of the backhoe moving toward the rear of me. And I'm thinking, if there's another one over there, it's coming around behind me, and they're going to have me trapped in here, and I'm about to get killed. I don't know. I don't remember identifying. They're going to beat me to death. They're going to rip me limb for limb. I've never seen anything like these things before. So, I mean, anything is possible. The mindset that I was in at the moment, or from the time I got out of the military to where I'm at this big plot of acreage with a big hole in it where I'm going to build a home for my wife and I, and I'm out here to get away from people. I don't like people. I don't understand them, and they don't understand me, is my mindset. I had lost a lot of friends in the military. I had lost a lot of friends to suicide after the military. And I was in a mindset where I really didn't care if I lived or died. People that have suffered depression get to that point, and you may have talked to people like this in the past. I really could care less if I die or if I stay alive. So I'm thinking to myself, I'm going to die tonight. This is it. So I took a stance like, okay, if we're going to do this, we're going to do this. And I got this idea that I'm going to point my gun at the creature in the hole, because that's the smallest one. I know I could probably take that one out. They're going to take me in a rush anyway. So I'm not going down without fighting. And I'm going to start with the weakest and work my way to the strongest. When I brought the barrel of the M4 down from the two that were across from me down into the hole, the one who looked like he was getting ready to jump over the pit let out this growl, this really low, loud growl that started. It felt like you hear people, you know, whenever you yell something, yell from the sternum. This was somewhere below the sternum, this thing started, and it just kind of boiled up and rolled out, and it was a loud growl. I've never heard anything like it, and it made me freeze for a moment. My barrel's pointing down. The creature, the beast that's on the other side of the hole that was to the right, put its hand out onto the shoulder of the other one, almost like it's saying, stop, don't do anything. In my mind later, I thought that may have been a sibling or a parent of the small one in the hole, because it's trying to get the other one not to do anything that's going to cause me to shoot it. So at that point, it puts its hand on the one next to it. I no longer hear movement from my left on the far side of the backhoe. I glance down in the hole. The thing that's down there is still jumping and trying to reach the edge of the hole so that it could get out. I thought to myself, maybe they're aggressive toward me because I'm a threat to the little one. So I took the barrel of my gun and I just moved it while I'm watching the two on the far side. I just moved it off the little one, maybe a foot to the right of the one that was in the hole. And then we just sat there staring at each other for what seemed like hours, but it was really only maybe 20 seconds. The one on the right that had been already down on the ground before, keeping its eyes on me, dropped back down onto the ground, reached down into the hole, grabbed the up-reaching arm of the one that was in the hole, and just kind of flung it, threw it out of the hole so that it landed behind him and stood back up again. And then they're just sitting there staring at me, and I'm staring at them. I did not make any move to move the barrel of my gun again. I did not bring it back up onto them. What I was threatening, I was no longer threatening, and I thought, if they attack me, I'm still in a position where I can put it on semi and just start pulling the trigger as fast as I can. If they don't, then they don't. And they started backing up slowly, and they got about 15 feet of backing up, and they turned around and just walked. They didn't run, they just walked back toward the tree line, which was about 50 yards beyond where we were. I glance over to my left, thinking that I want to catch a sight of the one that was over there. And it's no longer on the side of the backhoe. Now it's over near where I parked my truck, which was between the backhoe and the hole. And it was watching me. And once I could no longer see the two other ones and the little one, the big one that was watching me from over top of the truck started backing up and got no noise, backed up to where I could no longer see it. I sat there for a few seconds, and then I shined my flashlight up to where the two had been, and then back over to where my truck was to see if I could catch sight of any of them anymore, and they were gone. Then I went and started throwing everything. I went back into the camper. The sun was on its way up, and I started packing up my stuff, and I was going to get out of there, and that was the end of that. They were very similar in size and very similar in the way that they looked. I would say that they were between 8 and 9 feet tall. Their shoulders were easily 4 feet wide. Easily. The one that was standing on the left was a dark brown chestnut color. I say that because I recall whenever I would see horses, I don't know horses, but whenever I would see horses on TV, my dad or my wife who know horses would say, yeah, that's a chestnut color. So it was a chestnut color. It had hair from the top of its head all the way down to its feet. I don't remember if it was like a hobbit and had hair on the top of its feet. The hair looked like it was about 4, maybe 5 inches long all over its body. The neck and head and face was covered in this 4 to 5 inch hair. The shoulders and down its arms and down its legs, the hair looked longer, not as thick though. It was more wispy. It was maybe 8 to 10 inches long. And I would say that one was 800 pounds minimum. One on the right, the hair was a little darker, but the face was lighter. Let me go back to the one on the left. The one on the left, the skin that I could see on its palms and on its face was dark brown, almost like a Hershey bar, chocolate bar. It was dark brown. They both had a very pronounced eyebrow ridge, which made its eyes seem like they were sunken, but I think because the eyebrow ridge was so protruding, I don't think the eyes were sunken in conjecture with the rest of its face. Their faces were wide, really wide, like, this is in no way meant to be racist at all, but whenever you look at a lot of Asians' faces, their faces are really wide and flat. That's the way these faces were. Not chubby cheek, just wide and flat with a pronounced brow ridge. I didn't notice ears. The hair went all the way up its neck, right up to its bottom lip. But I didn't notice any hair on its upper lip unless it was really faint. The nose looked like a mushroom nose or a button nose that you would see on a person, but the nostrils were a lot wider. The nostrils probably went out an inch on either side of its nose. Nostrils pointed down, not out. To me, it did not look like an ape. I've heard people say they look like ape. There was nothing protruding the way an ape has its mouth, jaw, nose area protruding out from the rest of his face. There was none of that. Its lips were really thin. Its eyes were bigger than a human's eyes, really dark. I couldn't pick a color. I could see whites on either side when their eyes got big, but their eyes were really close together. that seemed closer together than what it should be to make the symmetry of its face the way, you know, in comparing it to a human face, I guess. Its hairline started about an inch above its brow ridge. The one on the right, very similar in appearance. The lips were fuller. The skin was lighter, but its hair was a little darker. The hair was a darker brown, and its skin was, I had told you before, the only color I can compare it to that people would understand was like cardboard box color, was the color of its skin. I didn't pay any attention to the feet. I really didn't pay any attention to it, their hands. I was watching body and head. That one was slightly taller than the one on the left. I don't know that they looked very similar, but not exactly alike. That one didn't have as much hair on its face. Again, the hair did not come, instead of going all the way up to its bottom lip, the hair came up to the chin and stopped, but it was all down, it was longer hair, you know, 4 to 5 inches all down the front and sides of the neck, the sides of the face, but it didn't really go up past the chin on its face. The one that I had appeared to the left that I saw toward the end of the encounter was massive. It was probably the biggest living thing that I've ever seen outside of a zoo. It was easily, I would estimate it as between 10 and a half and 11 feet tall. Using my truck as a comparison, it was as wide at the shoulder as the hood of my truck. But it looked at me from over my truck, I said earlier, but it wasn't looking at me from over the hood of my truck. It was looking at me from over the cab. And I could easily see half of its body, the upper half of its body, from over the cab of my truck. It was the biggest thing I've ever seen. It appeared all black. I could see the face. I could slightly see the facial features, but the hair looked black and the skin looked black. And I only saw it for such a brief time that I didn't really get a good description of it. Its face wasn't shiny. None of their face seemed to have that oil that we get on our face. They weren't shiny. They were dull. Like their skin didn't emit oil the way our skin emits oil. It was quite a presence once I saw it. The presence that I saw visually did not match the presence I perceived on the far side of the backhoe. Perception-wise, it seemed like it was a lot smaller because it wasn't making as much. It was making noise. I could hear it, but not as much noise as it moved. But I didn't hear it move from the side of the backhoe back to the backside of my truck, and I didn't hear it move whenever it backed away into the dark. So I don't know how something that big moved like that without making any noise. But my ears were still ringing from the adrenaline of the encounter, from the roar scream of both these other things, and from the growl. So maybe I just didn't identify it. Maybe I was probably most definitely in shock.
A lot of people report hearing a woman screaming, or what sounds like a woman screaming, in the woods. And we know there are certain animals that can make that sort of sound, felines, that sort of thing. But there's a lot of outdoorsmen, people who know those noises, have come forward and said, I heard a woman screaming. It wasn't any animal I've ever heard before. And the one thing that stays with me about John's account is that noise he heard of a woman screaming. It was actually coming from the little one in the hole. Just kind of a fascinating takeaway. Delilah grew up on this property out there in Virginia. She grew up, her grandfather owned, I believe it was 300 acres, and it was this huge piece of land. And growing up on this property, her grandfather would tell her, along with all of the kids, the grandkids, watch out for the old man in the woods. And she never knew really what he was talking about. She said growing up on this property, weird things would happen, but she never saw anything. Her grandfather passes away and parcels out the land to different family members. And 30 years ago, Delilah moved back on that property, built a home, and had a scary encounter. It reminded me a lot of Claire's account from episode 515.
Hadn't been married very long. I've been married about a year. And I married my childhood sweetheart. The few years prior to that, after leaving school, graduating and everything, I became a professional singer in Nashville, and I started traveling and writing and performing. And then I accidentally ran into this guy that I had gone to high school with and had really been raised with him. You know, they were down the road about 5 miles, but they were neighbors. And his family was a little affluent, and we weren't. We had a lot of land, but we were poor. And you have to excuse me, I got a bad cold. But he ended up coming to Nashville and talking me into marrying him, and I married him. And from day one, it was just a big mistake. And he was very abusive, and you know, I ended up in the hospital with brain concussions and chunks spit out of my face, and you know, and it was really hard for me to sing or work anymore. I had done some work as a model, and you know, you can't do that when you're all beat up and they don't know if you're going to be alive from one day to the next. So I was sick, about 6 months pregnant, and the sergeant of arms of Congress up there had called and asked me if I would do an event for them. And I wanted to do this event because I really missed a lot of my friends. And my husband had isolated me. He wouldn't let me have friends. You know, it was just really bad thing. So one day I just decided to say, look, I want to do this event. And so he said some really ugly things to me pertaining to me being poor when I grew up, and you know, and just because I had been out in the world and I had worked with rich people and been around fancy politicians, that I really was nothing, because he knew where I come from, and I was nothing, and I was never going to be nothing. And that hurts really bad, because you're in love with this person and you're standing there 6 months pregnant, and I wanted to lash back out at him, because I'm really not a pansy person. I was raised rough and tough. But I just couldn't do it. He just hurt that spot in me. I just couldn't get it out of my mouth without crying. And I didn't want him to see me crying. So our home sits deep in the woods, totally surrounded by woods. No near highway, just isolated. And so I just said, okay, I'm going to do what I always do, you know. I'm going to walk out into the woods and, you know, just I'm going to go out there and be by myself and do my little prayers and things, you know, and try to get my head straight and figure out what I'm going to do about this marriage that's not working. And so I walked probably half a mile back into the woods, and you have to go up a slope, right steep slope, and then when you get back there, the woods are just, they open up, and they're just these tall, old virgin timbers, and they're just really pretty. So I sat down in front of a big old oak tree up there, and I had my knees pulled up against me, and my hands, my arms on my knees, and my head and my arms, and I'm boo-hooing, and I'm sulking, and I'm disappointed and frustrated, and I'm talking to God. And then probably 15 minutes later, I hear this like a snort or a huff or like something like puff, you know, trying to get my attention. And I didn't raise my head immediately because I thought, you know, a deer has done walked up on me or something, and it's just now seeing me. But when I raised my head up. Anything else that had ever been on my mind was gone. And what I saw in front of me terrified me. My whole body was just trembling, and was so scared. It affected me, that initial seeing this thing. I felt my baby jumping inside of me. That's how bad and panicked it made me. I was just panic stricken. It didn't even come in my head to run or to stand up. I just was looking at this thing. I knew it was there. It really looked human, but it was down on its belly, like looking at me. And from where he was, I guess he is probably about 30 feet from me. And he was just right there in front of me, big, 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 big fella. Nothing exists that big, you know, bigger than a grizzly bear. And I've seen grizzly bears bigger than a grizzly bear. And he's just got these big black eyes and this black leathery face. And he's down on his belly looking at me. And I know that I'm sitting there with my mouth open. I'm wanting to scream, but I can't get anything to come out. And he's there on his belly. And I'm just like, oh, Lord, what is this thing? But at the same time, I don't know why, because I wasn't thinking of my grandpa. But when I saw this thing, I instinctively knew this must be the thing that Grandpa had told me about my whole life. And now there this thing was. And here I am, 6 months pregnant, and this thing is standing there. And you know, I was waiting for him to charge me, I guess. I was just waiting for him to charge me. And he stood up. At ground, when he was on the ground, he was probably about 3 foot tall, standing from the ground on his belly. But when he stood up, like my comparison that I had tried to tell you, was if I had been standing beside a semi-truck, if I was sitting on the ground beside a semi-truck and looked up, my head would have been all the way back looking up at how tall he was. He had to have been every bit of 9 feet and maybe more, because I was so scared. I wasn't counting feet or anything. But when he stood up, my eyes were like at his knee level. And I could see he didn't have much hair on his knees. And I guess maybe I just figure if you're crawling around a lot on your knees, you're going to have bare spots on your knees. And his hands were really leathery, but you know, I could see every digit in them. It's strange when you're that scared. And then afterwards, you sit there and think, when you know you're finally safe, you think about what you saw. And I saw every digit in his fingers. But he had his left arm, when he stood up, his left arm just slid up the tree beside him, which I'm not sure, it's probably a poplar or something right there. But when he stood up, he had his hand up above his own head. And he would do like this, lean forward, crouch, and like swivel swing. You know, like go back and forth, swivel swing. And If that wasn't enough to scare me, he had an erection. And boy, you know, I'm thinking, this is it. I'm going to be somebody's supper and nobody will find me. They're never going to know what happened to me. And they're going to have all these search parties out looking for me. And I'm standing there looking at him. And he has this peculiar look in his face. And you can tell that there's intelligence because it was like a meeting of the mind. He knew that I knew. You know, it's like we were totally aware that we were different from each other. But, and he knew that I was afraid because, I mean, there's no way that he didn't know he wasn't dominating over me. And he actually, with this huge mouth, he did something like when we were little kids, my brothers and I would run around, we'd take our finger and stick it on the inside of our cheek and make a little popping sound, like, you know. And that's what he was doing with his mouth. And I remember his nose was like a magenta color up inside his nose. His nostrils were, he had a real wide nose. I remember one night I was watching TV and Carl Malden was on. And Carl Malden has this big, bulbous nose. I don't know if you know who I'm talking about or not. Carl Malden was a famous actor, and he had this big bulbous nose that where he used to play college football. His nose had been broken so many times and so misshapen. And if you look up Carl Malden, you'll see the kind of nose this thing had. But he kind of had his head tilted just a little bit back. And it was like a magenta color up inside his nostrils. And that's one of the reasons that I called you. I've not listened to many of these shows because it kind of makes me real anxious. It takes me like a week or so to get my nerves down because, like, the more I talk about it, I'll start getting more rapid and the anxiety starts building. Although I'm trying to remain calm when I speak about it. But he had that magenta look up in his nose, and his mouth was so wide, he could have swallowed a softball and not give it another thought. And he had these huge, blocky teeth. He was showing his teeth, and I swear he grinned at me. And he stuck his tongue out at me. I can't even tell you. People say their life flashes before them. I didn't see anything like that. All I knew was, here's that thing Grandpa told me about, and I have screwed up, you know. And he stuck his tongue out at me. And I didn't really, I think I was crying. But I wasn't aware that I was crying because I was so upset and I peed my pants and I thought my water might break. I might have my baby, you know, right there at that tree. And it was just, I was in a terrible, terrible fix. And then all of a sudden, boom, and the whole ground shook under me. And I know I winced and shut my eyes, and when I opened my eyes up, there was one standing right in front of me. Right in front of me. If I'd have just stuck out my hand, I could have pulled the hair off his leg. I was terrified. I thought, oh my gosh, it's two of them. They're going to kill me. They're going to kill me. That's what was going through my head. I'm going to die. I'm going to die. I want to tell my mom and them I'm okay. You know, those were the things I was thinking. I just want them to know what happened to me. And they were fussing. That's the best way I can put it. They were fussing each other. She was bawling him out. And I say she because when the whole thing was over, she turned around to face me. And I think I'd done cut a hole in that tree. And she just looked down at me and kind of cocked her head as if to say, now get out of here while you can. And I still couldn't move. I still couldn't move. But that's what happened. And they stood there. He was really mad. I mean, she was chewing him out. It's exactly what it sounded like. It sounded like a couple in a foreign language, and it did sound like a language. It absolutely. This was no roof, roof, roof like a dog or a meow, meow, meow. These things, they knew what each other was saying. And apparently, she was telling him to leave me alone. Yeah, that's what they sound like. And it's almost like burps and clicks and growls, but they put it all together. And it sounds like a language when it's coming out. But it's kind of like a Morse code. It's like the burps and the clicks and the pops and then the grunts and, you know, the way they're emoting it, it just comes out like a language. After she looked at me and looked down at me, and I remember looking up and her breasts were hanging. She had big breasts. I mean, it would all, to a woman, she looked to me like she might have been nursing herself because her breasts were very full and voluptuous. She, you know, when I looked at Patty film, this one's breasts looked full, like she was nursing maybe, but she looked down at me like, okay, now get up, you know, and go. And she turned around, and I still sat there. I could not get up. I couldn't get up. And finally, when I was able to get up, you know, it's like God kind of talks to me sometimes, and these things come in my head, and he'll say, all right, you got to do this. And it was like God was saying, get up. Get up, Delilah, get up. So I got up, and I didn't want to look back. I was scared to death because actually the way I came into the woods, say I'm going north, I went in and sat down in front of a tree that was on the north, looking back toward where I come from, my yard. He was standing directly in the path back to my house. So I knew I had to go in that direction to get to my house, and I hadn't seen where he had gone. And I really don't know how something that big, I couldn't see him anywhere when I glanced around. And I saw her moving off to my right. So I just took off. And I would glance back every now and then, and she stayed right there in the vicinity where I was until finally I couldn't see her anymore.
Most of Delilah's family have actually encountered the creature. When Delilah shared with everyone what happened to her, cousins, sisters, people were coming forward and saying, yeah, I had this happen to me on the property. And Delilah often thinks back to her grandfather who told her, watch out for the old man when you're in the woods. Makes you wonder what he experienced. I had John and his wife, Leanne, on from, and they're from Ontario. And it was I believe it was a family property that they had. And John had a very strange experience. Let's take a listen.
We have family that own a rural piece of property outside of a town in here in Ontario, Canada, called Chesley, Ontario. Small place, like population's like 1,800 people, and it's very rural where we were staying. And so we go there every year, and we spend a weekend with them. And it's a give people an idea. Like, it's no power to this property, no hydro, no lights, no electricity, no lights. If you want, outhouse is your bathroom. And it's a great place for this family of ours to get away from the city. They live down in the city. So we always meet up with them and go there because it's only about an hour drive from where we live. So we showed up on one particular weekend. It was late when we arrived, and we had a late dinner. And when dinner wrapped up, it was getting dark, and actually it was getting quite dark. And we decided, well, let's have a bonfire. We'll have a couple of drinks and just everybody socialize and catch up. And so prior to that, I just thought, I'm going to take a little walk and, I'm going to go water some bushes, right? I just, had to go. And so I walked off around the corner, and it's I'm on this property. You're out in the middle of nowhere. There's no streetlights. There's no nothing. It's a road that's only just recently been kind of blacktopped. And so I just went around the far side of the bush and, do my thing. And as I'm standing there, I was looking over to the property next door, and it's a small farm. And if I had to guess, we were talking about like a 40-acre, 50-acre small farm. And the thing about this property, every time I've gone there, and we've gone there year after year, is that the guy's got his property lit up like a Christmas tree all summer long. He's got spotlights out the back, the front, and all the sides. And the one spotlight goes all the way to the bush line, which is going to be from the barn to the bush. It's going to be, you're somewhere around the football field. It's about 100 yards. And I'm standing there and I'm thinking, like, man, like your electricity bill must be out of sight. And he has sheep. And he keeps sheep from the spring to the fall. And I guess whatever he does, if they're for meat or whatever, they're gone. And, I've asked the people that own the property that we stay with, is it like this every night? And they said all summer long until he gets rid of the sheep. And the sheep aren't left out at night. He puts them in this really well-built barn. So anyway, I'm just looking at that, and I'm just thinking, like, man, like, those spotlights must just eat power, and your bill must be nuts. But so anyway, as I'm there, I catch some motion off to my left. And I actually heard what sounded like a rocks tumble, and there's a really deep ditch from the road. And where we are, like, it's all bush and farms, and there's no subdivisions, no nothing. It's like when you're out there, it's dark, right? And I hear the sound, and I'm looking over, and because of the light shine coming from this property that's all lit up, I can see a bit of a silhouette of something moving from the ditch. And the people we're staying with, they've had a problem where one time when they were there, people come around and probably figuring looking to steal like ATVs or dirt bikes. And that's the first thing that goes to my head. Like, and when this, what I thought was a person come up out of the ditch, you could clearly see that they were being careful how they walked. And by that, I mean, like, sometimes the arm would kind of go to the side. The feet, when it would, I could basically see it from the waist up. But sometimes it would lift its legs and place them down, going over small trees and shrubs. And you could tell it was being careful, trying not to make noise. And at this point, this is 40 feet away from me. And I don't know if it saw me, whatever, I don't know. But it began to angle away from me. And as it angles away, it's actually getting closer to the spotlights, the kind of the boundary of these lights, if you will, how far the light was reaching. And I'm about to yell, like, hey, who is this? Just as I was going to do that, as it turned, I got the whole, like, profile of the head, see it on a side view. And it, I'll be honest, like, it just kind of like, whoa. And I remember, like, I'm just like, what the F is this? If I was to describe it, it was like egg-shaped. I've heard people on your show use the word conical, I believe. and I would use the term conehead. I'd never heard of the conical before, but it like had a like a big cone head and a very protruding jaw is what I saw. And as it kept walking, what really like that head freaked me out because I was just like, it's not, no person has a head shape like this. And then what really, and I was about to still gonna like yell like, hey, and then the arm reached out as it went to go over these small trees that had been planted. They've been reforesting part of this area. And when the arm reached out, just the sheer length of it, I was just like, I remember I was just in shock. I was like, what the hell am I looking at? And as it kept angling away, it's getting closer to where the boundary of the light is, and I'm seeing it better and better. And then it walked out of this kind of shrubby undergrowth area, if you will, to now it's into a mowed area where the grass has been mowed or the lawn has been mowed. And it's kind of at the boundary of the light that's shining from this farm next door. And it's still walking on the property of the people that we stay with. But now I can see the full silhouette. And as it walks, like I'm getting the profile, it had a minuscule neck, if at all. When it turned its head, you could see this little bit of a neck. The head, as I said, was massive. It actually looked too big for the body. To describe the body, it would be like a basketball player, but not like a guy that's all jacked up, like, you know, not like a LeBron James or something like that. A thin build. It looked like it was about my height. So we're talking 6 foot. It might have been as much as 6'6", maybe. The ground we're on is level, so we're pretty well level with each other. And as it's angling away, it's now 50-odd feet away. And when it walked, it was very casual the way it walked. I remember the arms, the length of them as it kind of walked, if it stopped and just held them down straight, the fingers would have been past where your kneecap is, where the kneecap is. Like, they're long, long arms. And this thing is like a long, lanky thing, right? And I'm not going to lie. I was kind of freaked out because I couldn't, like, what is this? I couldn't, you know, what is, I can't, you know, this is not a man. There's no doubt. At least that's how your head's going. And just as I'm about to yell, and I was going to yell to people with fire, because I'll be honest, I was a little uncomfortable. I didn't know what I was looking at. And just as I'm about to do that, this thing just all of a sudden starts to run. And it's running basically on the boundary of the properties, the light. It's like a perfect silhouette. So we're black on our side because there's no light on our side, but it's all lit up over there where this farm is. And in three strides, this thing got moving at a pace like there's no possible way this is a man. There's no way. I don't care. You know, Usain Bolt, could nothing. There's no possible with like three strides. And I mean, it is going. And the other thing about when it ran, and I still to this day, like it was 3 years ago, I saw this. At some point, at least once a week, this will go through my head because your head doesn't know where to put it because you don't know what it is. The arm movement, like literally, if you look at like a sprinter, you get your arms at a 90 degree. The bicep, when it come forward, like the arm would come forward, the bicep is facing the sky. And then when it would place its arm and go behind it, it would actually like get beyond 180 degrees. So the bicep is now at the ground. And then the elbow, even with how big this thing's head was, would almost like be look like it was reaching up as height of its top of its head. Like, so I don't know how many degrees that would be. It was like well over 200 degrees. And it only did that kind of a motion, I'm going to say, for its first 12, 15 strides. And then it kind of a more of a normal arm motion as it ran. But it was like, I mean, this thing's moving, right? And again, as I said, like from the spotlights where they are on the barn to where the tree line is, it's a good football field, right? And this thing ran parallel to the so it's not like directly in the spotlights. And then as the lights get dimmer, as you get closer to the back of the property, it began to cut across. So it didn't do like a straight line. It kind of did this little jog to its right, and it kind of ran to the middle of the field and then back out again. And again, just going like there's no tomorrow. I mean, I just couldn't get my head around the speed, right, what I'm seeing. And as it cut across the field, and now the light is on it a lot better, I can see that it's got, looks like brown hair all over the entire body. it's at one point its back was to me as it's going away, and like I said, you could see the brown hair. And then the part that really blew my mind as it, I'm gonna guess, let's say it's 20 yards, 20, 25 yards from the tree line. This thing, again, it's just going flat out, and it's running like parallel to me. So I'm looking at it from the side, and all of a sudden, it's just like, I thought it tripped. And it's like the whole body is just heading forward. It's off its feet. Now its chest is parallel to the ground. I don't know how high it would be. It would be 6 to 10 feet off the ground. And it's like it dove forward. I initially thought it tripped. That was my, what went in my mind. And then just as it's about to hit the ground, it catches itself with its, and I should mention, when it did this, like this move where it kind of dove forward, the arms were straight out at its side. Like, I mean, just straight out, like you were making a cross, eh? Just like straight out. And then, as it's about to come to the ground, the arms come down, the arms catch it, the back legs start pumping, and this thing took two massive strides, and like a dog would run, and it's in the bush, and it went into the bush at full speed. Like, I mean, it wasn't slowing down. It wasn't like, that wasn't a way to slow it. It just like, boom. And then I would, if I had to take a guess, it may be bad, I would say that it was even faster on all fours than it was on 2 feet. And, you know, and in retrospect, when I look back on this, and I, like I said, for 3 years, I've just, you know, every week there's some, I'll have a dream about it, or I'll just be driving and there's nothing going on and it'll play over my head. Two things. It was almost like when it jumped out with its arms like that at its side. And so it's almost like when I look back now, that I don't think it tripped. It was almost like exuberance or showboating, or, you know, like if, you know, if we, a touchdown or hit a three-pointer, you know what I mean? How people, it was just so
kind of showing like off.
That's how I took it, right? Like a showboating move. And the other thing I'm thinking, at the point where it was good, like it's getting dark now because the light has reached its limit, this thing hit a forest that's got shrubs, rocks, trees, you know, the whole flat out. Like, this thing must be able to see well in the dark, because I mean, like, if you and I ran into a bush flat out in the pitch black, we're gonna flatten ourselves on a tree, right? And like, it was just what. And then the other thing too, if I'm going to give this a time frame, I'm going to say that thing went that 100 to 120 yards, like I said, when it kind of cut across the field, that takes more distance. It covered that entire time frame. And I've done this over my head and over 4 to 5 seconds, and it was gone. The initial part of it, I probably watched it, I'm going to say, for about 20. And coming up, maybe even a little bit longer, coming up out of the ditch and then a whole bit, because it was just walking at a very slow pace, so you could tell it was being careful. But when it hit that, the speed that it covered that field in was insane. And, you know, you and I, when we talked the other day, you talk about how, like, your brain doesn't know what to do with, or how to put, you made this comment about your brain can't put it in a box. And that's exactly where I'm at with this. And one of the things that I guess I'm thankful for is that if it had not done that move at the end where it kind of ran like a dog, I probably would have talked myself into the fact that that was just some guy. He saw me, he was startled, and I would have convinced myself that, yeah, maybe there's a guy out there who can run that fast, even though deep down inside, you know, there's no bloody way, right? It just couldn't happen. Basically, in a nutshell, that's what happened. And the whole thing, 30-odd seconds, let's say. But it's life-changing, because I still, to this day, like I told you, my head doesn't know what to do with it. I think about it all the time.
You know, when I very first put this show together, it was originally going to be about 4 or 4.5 hours long, and I've been, all week long, I've been trying to really trim out and try and get it down to more 2 hours, because I realize no one's going to sit here for 4 hours. But what a year it's been. I really appreciate you guys taking the time to listen to the show. I know I wasn't supposed to come back. I was going to take vacation till the beginning of the year, but I wanted to stop by and wish you guys the best. Thanks so much for taking the time to listen. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And if you get a chance to check out sasquatchchronicles.com, you can become a member and get additional shows. Until next time, everyone.